Okay, hey everyone, welcome back. So our next session is based on 3 months of intense data research and foot traffic analysis. And I'm pleased to welcome Drew Breunig, who is the SVP of Strategy at PlaceIQ. And he's gonna take you all through the changes in consumer behavior during this time of social distancing, what the data means to marketers, and also offer a detailed playbook to help you solve today's unique challenges. Drew, over to you.
Hi, all. Thanks, Cheryl, for the introduction. And thanks, you all, for coming to spend some time with us. As we go, feel free to plug in questions and comments into the chat as you see fit. Love to have that feedback and hear some stories about how everyone is faring during this unique time. So we at PlaceIQ are in a super interesting position, and we realized that right when kind of all of this kicked off. So we have a view of how people move around outside their homes, which seems like it would be pretty relevant these days, and it is. So what we started to do is we started to establish and structure a research program and staff it with some of our best people to help understand what is happening as we go from week to week. One of the reasons this monitoring is so important is because this is, you know, something that's never happened before. So monitoring is generally better than modeling confronted with something that has never happened before. You can either try to look at all of these different kind of figures that plug in, or you can just watch what happens. And we have a great data source that sees over 200 million devices in the United States. We can see how they change, and we only see that with a 3-day delay. So it's pretty fantastic. So what did we see happening within our social distance tracker, which is the name we're calling it? And if you'd like to join, either shoot me a note or just go to our website and sign up for our newsletter, and you'll receive 1 to 2 updates a week with a lot of the figures that I'll be sharing here. We're on our 16th edition, which is something that I am ridiculously proud of our team for assembling in such short order with kind of, you know, never been done before. So let's take a look at what happened. So the first thing that was interesting is we started to see the emergence of very specific phases. And this was novel because we were seeing it emerge in real time. So what you're looking at here is a chart, and the y-axis here is traffic versus February norms. So we looked at February norms. So we basically looked at all the average traffic, foot traffic to various categories for Monday in February, for Tuesday in February. And we use this as a benchmark to compare all of our post-COVID traffic to pre-COVID traffic. And the first phase that occurred was what we called the panic and prepare phase. This was the phase that was kicked off March 11th, which is when the NBA decided to suspend its season, and Tom and Rita Hanks were revealed to be in the hospital. This is when it hit home for everybody. And what was really interesting about this phase, this panic and prepare phase, is that with no cues from any kind of official or government agency, people kind of all acted in unison due to these cultural cues. They all rushed out. A few things spiked their foot traffic. So grocery stores, big box, pharmacy, all of these received record traffic in very short order. But then immediately after seeing record traffic, they shot down to, you know, basically lows we have never seen before. Things that were not in the kind of preparation set. You know, things like malls, things like offices, things like public transit, they just shot straight down. Some of these continued falling after the fact, but we basically, what's interesting about this panic and prepare phase is this was a 10-day shock that saw everybody running out, no one kind of knowing what was happening. But the end of this phase is when the first official orders. So on 3/20, California is the first state to issue its shelter in place orders. Now, one of the reasons that this is notable for marketers and for, you know, everybody else is that We've all been kind of watching these official orders rolling out. And what this section and chart shows us is that people acted way before the orders occurred, which hints to us, and we'll see later, is that people will sometimes preempt and sometimes ignore orders. You'll see the lifting of shelter in places and traffic not returning, or you'll see shelter in place orders remain and traffic start to return. So what's interesting about this is that cultural cues drove us into sheltering in place before any official orders happened, and we did it as a nation. We all did it all at once. And after we did that, took about 10 days, and that's when we established our new kind of what we call the quarantine routine. That's our second phase. This is when the kind of weekly cycle started to reemerge. So I've been at PlaceIQ for close to a decade, which is crazy. But as we started to look at our data since then, we've always seen kind of a weekday routine. You know, certain things spike on Monday, traffic to gym spikes on Monday, grocery shopping spikes on Saturday, casual dining spikes on Friday. There's this weekly rhythm that is only disrupted by holidays and extreme weather events. And it's usually only interrupted for a day or two. This panic and prepare phase is nothing we've ever seen before. For 10 days, there was no weekly rhythm. It just completely was gone. And it took us 10 days to reestablish a weekly rhythm. And that's what we call the quarantine routine. So what happened during the quarantine routine? What did our lives look like while we were sheltering in place? Foot traffic was down significantly, but it varied by category. Quote unquote, essential retailers like grocery and big box, they were down roughly about 30%. And you can kind of start to see some tiers emerging here. There's the what I would call the kind of the 30% club, which is grocery, big box, and pharmacy, which are the big essential retailers, but also fast food. Fast food kind of was elevated into a tier one category because drive-through was already established from a consumer awareness perspective. It's super safe. People felt comfortable doing it. And it's an affordable luxury. So if your finances are impacted, this is still something you can do. Tier two, auto dealerships, coffee shops, and fast casual dining. Those were all of the kind of things that were more, you know, hey, you know, some people do it, some people don't, but it kind of, you know, it was the things you had to second guess during the quarantine routine. Hey, my car's broken. Can I take it into the service center? Is that even still open? A lot of, we saw spikes in Google searches for, you know, is the dealership open or is the service open? Cars would still break during the quarantine and people didn't know what to do with them. And turns out they can take them to dealerships. So that was kind of our tier two. These were the places that were suffering, but not as bad as tier three. And this is the early days. So nature and outdoors, airports, we'll talk about nature and outdoors later. And casual dining. Casual dining was, I think, kind of the most severely impacted business that was actually still open. You know, malls were closed, airports were, you know, ghost towns. And we had this kind of bottom tier. In addition to traffic dropping, it didn't just drop, but it was also different. So here is a distribution of when people shopped. So this is a during weekdays, when did people shop at Trader Joe's? And the takeaway is that when you don't have to do a commute, when you don't have kind of drop your kids off at school, your traffic gets spread throughout the day. So if you look at this, the orange bars, you can see that there's kind of a spike during rush hour. At Trader Joe's, so on weekdays, so 5 a.m., 6 p.m. This is when we see it's kind of a bell curve, but it leans towards rush hour. When you remove the commute, when you look at kind of post-COVID traffic, you see an almost perfectly even bell curve. It basically spreads all its traffic throughout the morning and throughout the day. We also saw it spreading throughout the entire week. Trips to grocery store usually happen on Friday, Saturday. We saw those decline a little bit and start to pick up on Monday and Tuesday. So, you know, the phrase that always pops into my mind is the phrase, the doldrums, you know, the place in the ocean where you kind of have no wind. If you're sailing a ship, I find that metaphor works here, which is we were kind of in the doldrums. We didn't have our normal commute to keep our daily routine. We didn't have our normal kind of errands. And so what happened is, all of the things that we had to do, like go to the grocery store, got spread out because there wasn't anything blocking it. They could now be in the morning, they could now be throughout the week, and we saw kind of fewer trips longer and spread out. And you can see that spreading out here. So this is kind of what our weekly routine looked like. Before, we were looking at the hour of the day. Here, we're looking at the day of the week. And we're seeing, hey, you know, you can see grocery starts to pick up right on the weekend. Now it's almost flat. You can see just a little bit of things pops, but you can see these things are generally sloping upwards. Here they're almost flat. And so we see that kind of less traffic, but it's also different. And the other thing that's important, and this is kind of the general thing of the commute, and something to keep in mind and something we touched on in our last newsletter, is with the removal of going to work and working from home, people just stay within kind of a 3-mile radius of their home. They're not going very far. Even if they start to visit these places at an increased frequency, they stay very close. So casual restaurants, this chart shows you how far people were driving to casual restaurants. Previously, they would drive 6.5 kilometers. Now they only drive less than 5, and 5 kilometers is roughly 3 miles. So that's down 25%. Coffee shops down 16%. Fast food down 13%. And we see this all throughout, that even as visits to restaurants are recovering, they're starting to pick back up, and I'll show you this in a second, we're seeing a huge the pattern still very affected by the fact that we no longer have commutes. If you want to see this in more detail, I'll point you towards our website, placeiq.com. Click on the blog button in our navigation. And our most recent newsletter, we talk about how traffic is starting to pick back up to places like Chick-fil-A, McDonald's, whatever. But the breakfast and dinner meals are still barely visible. Everything has shifted into this kind of a lunch, middle of the day, this great flattening. Without commutes, QSRs lost 2 meals. They lost breakfast and they lost dinner. And that is hurting places that have invested quite significantly in the breakfast wars over the last couple of years. All right, so the takeaway here is that visits are not just down during the quarantine routine, they're different. And as we start to get into reemergence, and we'll talk about why I use that word reemergence, you need to remember that, which is even as visits come back, they still might be different. And a good example of that is that we see visits to QSR restaurants coming back, but because people still aren't going into the office, those visits are still fundamentally different. And we're starting to see a reemergence, but it's not back to what the norm used to be. So let's talk about what we call, you know, reemergence. So we very specifically use the word reemergence and reopening, and they describe two different things. So reopening is a bureaucratic kind of dictum. It is when a mayor or a governor says, hey, you know, casual restaurant dining rooms can reopen, okay? They may say that, and we saw that very early on in Georgia. They said that, and guess what? In the Atlanta County, no one really went to them, even though they were reopened. The Atlanta counties, there's two counties that make up Atlanta, I always get reminded. In rural counties, they started to visit them at a higher rate. But just because something is reopened doesn't mean that they will go and visit it. Similarly, even if something isn't reopened, like say fast food, their dining rooms were still closed until recently, but their traffic was almost at pre-COVID norms. It had climbed back up to what February looked like. And that was basically saying people had reemerged. They were comfortable going to fast food because it was drive-through, it was pickup, it was all these things, but it hadn't reopened yet. So I encourage you all as marketers to deal with these two very different things, which is there's reopening, which is our official orders, and then there's reemergence. And they vary by county. They vary tremendously by county, and I'll show you in a second. Even state is not granular enough. I encourage you all to go to county level when performing your analyses or your targeting, because the state level is not detailed enough to capture the nuances. And they kind of vary by county, and they vary by category. So a good example is, you know, my wife and I got an email saying our preschool was reopening 2 weeks ago. And we're like, we're not comfortable sending our kid there for reason X, but we feel comfortable eating out. It's a very personal thing, and it depends on kind of the local infection rates, the local perception of danger, the local politics, the local economy. All of these things affect whether or not reemergence is occurring. And here we can see, I've kind of established this third phase. These are fast food is green, fast casual is orange, and yellow is casual. And we can see them reemerging. You see this little spike right here. That's when the first dining rooms reopened. And you can see it didn't snap it back to norm. It was still down 40%. But you can see fast food was almost at, you know, its norm, you know, a month ahead of time. So this reemergence ramp is the thing that we're tracking now. Panic and prepare, quarantine routine, and the reemergence ramp. But this is a national chart. This is showing you what's happening at the nation. And remember, I said you need to track this at county, and I will show you why you need to track this at county. This is reemergence for McDonald's. The green counties are basically traffic is up compared to pre-COVID norms. So it's in this green county right here where my I don't know if I'm pointing, but if this green county right here, their traffic is back above where it was pre-COVID. But in the red counties, it's still down, and in some cases significantly so. So, and one of the things that I think is so interesting is these don't follow state lines. It's rural versus urban is actually a greater predictor, but even that is not a guarantee. So one of the things that we're advising marketers to do is you got to take into account county or more granular metrics, because if you were to run a campaign in, say, Georgia saying, hey, you know, our dining rooms are reopened, there's a whole lot of red counties in there that people are just not coming out. You're effectively wasting your marketing money telling them to do something that they're not ready to do. So you really, you got to use the data to figure out what is the schedule occurring at the different counties. And this is true even for the DMA as well. Here are the top 75 DMAs, same kind of pattern of chart where we're looking at traffic versus pre-COVID norms, and we're looking at fast food dining. And we can see during panic and prepare, all of these lines were really tightly coupled together. And as they start to reemerge, they all start to spread out. And you can see different counties have different things. And like I said, this is based on finance. This is based on local mores. This is based on local politics, local risk assessments. And you can see, what are these bottom lines down here? Well, they're Los Angeles, Detroit, San Francisco, Miami, New York, the places that were actually hit the hardest with the initial wave. What are the ones up here? You know, Kansas, Little Rock, Tulsa, Chattanooga, Memphis, places that had not been severely impacted yet and are starting to go back. So this is kind of raising a new challenge for marketers. And that's kind of when we get into the playbook. So we've got about 7-5 minutes left. And I want to sum this up is that we have these two takeaways that I think are the big challenges that every marketer is facing, which is that reopening and reemergence are different and don't always align. So as a marketer, you can't take the easy way out and basically just say, hey, I'm going to unpause my campaign or reinvest based on the statewide rules. That would be way easier. You could just follow 50 rules and just let it go. But we've seen in the data that the states are not granular enough because people aren't traveling and they're staying only 3 miles away from home. This is a county thing. This is a local community thing. It's not a statewide thing. So those geographies really don't mean too much right now. And reemergence is regional in nature. So gains in foot traffic vary widely by county and category. Rural communities are more likely to be out and about, but local economies, all these politics, infection rates, and perceived risk drive different behaviors. Now, the challenge for a marketer is, do you end up with 5,000 different line items for each county? Because now, like, you have this level of complexity that is through the roof because the level of complexity on the ground is through the roof. You're effectively marketing in you know, 5,000 environments. So smart marketers are going to take three tactics. They're going to monitor. So they're going to basically start to look where reemergence is occurring. The more granular you're able to monitor it, the better. I've kind of made fun of monitoring at the state level, but quite frankly, if you're working at the national level, state level is an improvement. Try to get as close to the metal as possible, down to the household if you can. The second thing you need to, as you monitor, is you need to segment. So when you go out and you target or you measure against certain audiences, you need to account for, is this audience emerging or not? If one household is running around because they're just bored of being inside and they have no you know, high-risk people in their household, that's going to be a much easier target to market to. Whereas if you target someone who's locked inside because they're living with grandma and they have no need to go outside and there's no kids, they're fine, you know, that's who you market for, you know, e-commerce and delivery. So different messages go to different segments. And then finally, you need to have measurement starting to return as we start to see this coming back. So how do you monitor? We've actually built a product for this case. We're looking at, we're building what we call a reemergence data set, which is just super simple visits and index. So, you know, if it has a one, that means it's up 100% versus year over year measurement. So you can see, hey, for June 15th, how am I doing versus last year? And it's at the county and category or brand, depending on how much data you want, level. So you can basically see and monitor in real time, hey, how am I doing versus last year? How are my competitors doing last year? And what are the metrics I should hold myself to? And is this county out and about yet? Or are they still tightly in? When should I turn this stuff on and off? And we have lots of different options. Which one is going to be the right one for your use case? Is it something that's a interactive dashboard because, you know, hey, I don't have a team of analysts who can pore over this data? Is it, you know, something I can use in Excel and Tableau? That's the reemergence data set. Or do I want the actual visit counts to each venue because I have my own data infrastructure? During this time, we recognize data is so important, so we're investing in making sure that people have data sets they can actually use. We're also going to help you with segments, the segments are super simple. At the household level, for every household that we have devices against, we separate them into three types of audiences. If they're not leaving that household, but we know there's devices here and they used to be active, that's strictly isolating. Maybe they go to maybe a grocery store every once in a while, but they're not making trips outside of that household. The second household is people who are making trips to grocery, big box, and they're not doing it just a little bit. They're doing it a good amount, but they're still not, you know, making tons of their normal trips. They're not going for haircuts, for example. And then we have the fully reemerged, which are people who are, you know, going out the most and visiting essential and non-essential businesses. This is a great tool for marketers because these audiences are big. We've priced them aggressively, so you can just overlay them across campaigns. And they wrap up all that complexity I was talking about. So we saw how reemergence varies by county to county and by category to category. You can use these audiences to take care of that complexity for you. And actually, they're built at the household level. They're not even built at the county level. And you can see how these are different based on how you're marketing to people. So if you're marketing to, you know, your fast food restaurant like McDonald's or Chick-fil-A or whatever, if someone's still sheltering, maybe you want to do delivery messaging. Maybe you want to talk about how there's, you know, low touch experiences by going through the drive-through. If people are starting to go out and starting to test the waters, you want to maybe get them to the meals that they're not doing right now. So, hey, reminding them breakfast is still on, dinner is still on. Start to get more aggressive with your messaging because they're starting to look for excuses to leave the house and they're okay doing that. For emergent regions, people who are out there running about, that's when you want to go back to your kind of like price, performance and assortment messages, product messages. You know, you don't have to worry about those messaging. So being able to segment these is really, really important. So that's where we're kind of wrapping up here is what is our playbook to manage the complexity that we are seeing as the nation starts to reemerge. And make no mistake, reemergence is not going to be in a direct line. It's going to go up, then it might go down, then it might go up, then it might go down as we start to see, you know, hot spots and cold spots break out. I hope it goes straight up and I hope hot spots don't break out, but you know, we want to, this monitoring is what's going to tell us and how we can kind of manage our investment. We've talked about how you segment, and basically if you're running campaigns at the national level, it really is kind of an inefficient manner. And we even think statewide is inefficient. There's just so much local complexity and changes in mood that don't follow the geographic boundaries we're used to. And then finally, if you can measure, please do, because it helps you kind of track against yourself and your competitors kind of handicapped against the reemergence environment. So with that, thank you for joining me. Like I said before, we have a great newsletter that goes out every week that is just data stories using the data we see. We love to hear ideas if there's a story you want us to cover. Please go to placeiq.com to sign up for our newsletter. And if you have any direct questions, feel free to email me. My email is drew, at placeiq.com. And we've just sent a little survey, I'm probably too late, asking about how what your biggest marketing challenges are during COVID. Very curious to hear about that so that we can tune our services and offerings as best we can to help you all. So thank you.